Continue on section 20.4. The next topic is multiple convolution. So after we define a convolution between two functions, we can keep doing that. Because a convolution is still a function, we can take a convolution of that with another function. So we have a convolution of three functions. So basically, if you have a function f, now convolution of f and with the convolution of g and another function h. Okay, so that would still be a convolution. So just by definition, this is just 1 over square root of 2 pi integrating the, let's see, what we have a dy. And this function is an x, right? So this is the function g convolution h and then x minus y. Okay, so that is the convolution. So, but then now the convolution of g and h is itself the same definition. So it's also 1 over square root of 2 pi. So all together is 1 over 2 pi dy. There's an f. There's actually an f times y, fy. Fy times this one, so you have Fy times, this one is a convolution. I think the textbook is a t in here, dt. And then g of t, and then h of x minus y minus t. Okay, so now, so this is by straightforward application, successive application of the convolution definition. Now, this is one way to define this, but you can define it a little differently by doing a transformation of variable, define t equals c minus y. So you define c equals to, or t equals z equals t plus y. So t will be z minus y. So this will be equals to 2 pi dy fy. This will be instead dt become dz. So g would be z minus y. H will be now t is so t plus y is z. So this is x minus z. Okay, so that's another definition, right? So again, the order of the operation actually doesn't matter. So all three function, the convolution, you can change the order. And then just like the convolution between two function, now this convolution f, g, and h, if the order doesn't matter, if you take the Fourier transform, you can take it all group two together because this would be the Fourier transform, like Fourier transform of f times 3 times 4 of G H convolution, which is 3 times 4 of F times 3 times 4 of G times 3 times 4 of H. So in your textbook now it's writing as F times F omega G omega H omega. Okay, so that's just a straightforward application. And then now, if you now substitute this into this convolution, and this is write down the inverse transform, okay? Because you have a 2 pi here, you multiply 2 pi to the other side, the inverse transform will have 1 over square of 2 pi in the denominator. So you can write dy dz fy gz minus y and h x minus z that is square of 2 pi integrating f capital F, capital G, capital H times the exponent e to the minus I omega. This is a function x, d omega. Okay, so, so that's the similarly, this is the inverse transform of the convolution of three function. And likewise, you can write down the similar result in three dimension. So let's write down, this is 20.85. This is for one dimension function. So for three dimension function, you have d cube r pi, d cube r double pi, and you have f vector r pi, g r double pi minus r pi h. R minus R double pi now equals to now instead of square root of 2 pi, you have 2 pi to the 3 half because it's 3 dimension. So you integrate F as a function of K, G as a function of K, H as a function of K, and E to the minus I K dot R. Integrating over the K space. Okay, so that is equivalent in the identity in three dimension. Okay, so so that all these are just very straightforward generalization for a convolution between two function. But sometimes in some situation you have convolution between three functions. So this is an example 20.4.3. So this is basically is a electric potential or electric potential energy, or at least proportional to that, integrating our pi. Integrating R double pi, then you have one function, one charge density depends on R pi, and another charge density. This is rho sub 1, rho sub 2, R double pi divided by the distance R pi minus R double pi. Okay, so this is. This is very similar to this function. Okay, so you have so this function is this f, and r double prime minus r, this is r, this is absolute value, so you can, this is g, okay. And then this one can be this one if you can be h, row two can be h, if you set row equal to zero, but then there's a minus sign, so what you get is the Fourier transform of that with a minus k dependency. I think I forgot that in the last example. The last example have the same situation, 20.4.2. So therefore, the Fourier transform have a negative k argument instead of k. Okay, but you can apply, compare this with that. And so you can write it into a integration in the space in k space. So that therefore the first one is the this one, so row one Fourier transform k. There's also this r prime r my double prime, so this one, so you can the Fourier transform of 1 over r. It's basically this function is just 1 over r. So 1 over r Fourier transform in k. And then you have a row 2 Fourier transform. But then remember this minus k because this is evaluated at the minus sign. Instead of the set r equal to zero. So basically yes, that is a minus sign here. Okay, so and then evaluate the e to the I k r, but r now either I k r, but r is set to zero. Okay, so this is e to the I k dot r, but this is zero, so this is one. All right. And then this one over r Fourier transform, we have done that before, so let's look that up again. So this is in the last, this is in equation 20.42. So one of r Fourier transform is 1 over 2 pi, so you have 4 pi over k squared. This is this is 20.42. So therefore this the V is equals to, so cancel with this factor 2 pi over 3 half, and then you have 4 pi here over 1 Fourier transform in K, and over 2 Fourier transform in minus K, and there's a d cube K divided by K squared. Okay, so that will be the form of the final formula. This is 20.90. So of course, we need to specify row one and row two in order to do this integral, but that's the general formula. And so that's an example for multiple convolution.